Hey guys, I hope everybody's having a great day. Today is Thursday, June the 25th, 2020, and I found this article and I thought it was interesting, so I wanted to share. It's from the American Psychological Association, the APA, and the name of the article is Revenge and the People Who Seek It. New research offers insight into the dish best served cold. It's by Michael Price, who is on the staff there. June 2009, Volume 40, Number 6, Print Version, Page 34. And there's a little voodoo doll there. Historically, there are two schools of thought on revenge. The Bible in Exodus 21:23. Instructs us to, quote, give life for life, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot, end quote, to punish an offender. But more than 2,000 years later, Martin Luther King Jr. responded, quote, the old law of an eye for an eye leaves everybody blind. Who's right? As psychologists explore the mental machinery behind revenge, it turns out both can be, depending on who and where you are. If you're a power seeker, revenge can serve to remind others you're not to be trifled with. If you live in a society where the rule of law is weak, revenge provides a way to keep order. But revenge comes at a price. Instead of helping you move on with your life, it can leave you dwelling on the situation and remaining unhappy, psychologists' research finds. Considering revenge is a very human response to feeling slighted, humans are atrocious at predicting its effects. The Avengers. Social psychologist Ian McKee, PhD of Adelaide University in Australia, studies what makes a person seek revenge rather than just letting an issue go. In May of 2008, he published a paper in Social Justice Research, linking vengeful tendencies primarily with two social attitudes: right-wing authoritarianism and social dominance, and the motivational values that underlie those attitudes. People, quote, people who are more vengeful tend to be those who are motivated by power, by authority, and by the desire for status, he says. They don't want to lose face. In the study, McKee surveyed 150 university students who answered questions about their attitudes towards revenge, authority, and tradition, and group inequality. He found that the students whose answers showed a deference to authority and respect for traditions and social dominance had the most favorable opinions about revenge and retribution. Those personalities, McKee says, quote, tend to be less forgiving, less benevolent, and less focused on universal connectedness type values. There's also a cultural dimension to people's predilection for revenge, says revenge researcher Michelle Gelfin, PhD, a professor of psychology at the University of Maryland, College Park. She and her collaborators, Gary Steinberg and Kim, have found that different events trigger the revenge process in different cultures. American students feel more offended when their rights are violated, whereas Korean students feel more offended when their sense of duty and obligation is threatened, they show in a paper in the January Journal of Cross-Cultural Psychology. That distinction could fuel intercultural conflicts with one side when one side seeks vengeance for a slight the other didn't even know it committed. For example, an American might be more likely to seek revenge on someone who impinges on his or her right to voice an opinion, whereas public criticism that embarrasses a Korean in front of his or her friends might be more likely to trigger revenge feelings. Geffen has also found that collectivists are more likely than individualists to avenge another's shame. To collectivists, shame to someone with a shared identity is considered an injury to oneself, she explains. As a result, she says, quote, revenge is more contagious in collectivist cultures. Quote, you just don't realize those situations are construed by the other culture as very important and self-defining, Geffen says. The emotions that fuel revenge may differ across cultures as well, says Gelfand. In her studies, she has found that anger often drives the vengeful feelings of people in individualistic cultures, while shame powers revenge in collectivist ones. The revenge paradox. Ask someone why they seek revenge, though, and they're likely to tell you their goal is catharsis, says Kevin Carl Smith, PhD, a social psychologist at Colgate University in Hamilton, New York. But exactly the opposite happens, according to a study he published in May of 2008, Journey of Personality and Social Psychology, Volume 95, Number 6. In a series of experiments, he and his colleagues, Daniel Gilbert, PhD at Harvard, and Timothy Wilson, PhD at the University of Virginia, set up a group investment game with students where if everyone cooperated, everyone would benefit equally. However, if someone refused to invest his or her money, that person would disproportionately benefit at the group's expense. Carl Smith planted a secret experimenter in each group and had them convince everyone to invest equally. But when it came time to put up the money, the plants defected. The free riders, as Carl Smith calls them, earned an average of $5.59, while the other players earned around $2.51. Then Carl Smith offered some groups a way to get back at the free rider. They could spend some of their own earnings to financially punish the group's defector. Quote, virtually everybody was angry over what happened to them, Carl Smith says, and everyone given the opportunity for revenge took it. He then gave the students a survey to measure their feelings after the experiment. He also asked the groups who'd been allowed to punish the free rider to predict how they'd feel if they hadn't been allowed to, and he asked the non-punishing groups how they thought they'd feel if they had. In the feeling survey, the punishers report feeling worse than the non-punishers, but predicted they would have felt even worse had they not been given the opportunity to punish. The non-punishers said they thought they would feel better if they'd had that opportunity for revenge, even though the survey identified them as the happier group. In other words, both groups thought revenge would be sweet, but their own reported feelings agreed more with MLK Jr. than with Exodus. The results suggest that, despite conventional wisdom, people, at least those with westernized notions of revenge, are bad at predicting their emotional states following revenge, Carl Smith says. The reason revenge may stoke anger's flames may lie in our ruminations, he says. When we don't get revenge, we're able to trivialize the event, he says. We tell ourselves that because we didn't act on our vengeful feelings, it wasn't a big deal, so it's easier to forget it and move on. But when we do get revenge, we can no longer trivialize the situation. Instead, we think about it a lot. Quote, rather than providing closure, it does the opposite. It keeps the wound open and fresh, he says. Revenge or justice? If revenge doesn't make us feel any better, why do we seek it? Carl Smith describes one evolutionary hypothesis suggested by German psychologists Ernst Fuhrer, PhD, and Simon Getcher, PhD. Quote, punishing others in this context, what they call altruistic punishment, is a way to keep societies working smoothly, Carl Smith says. You're willing to sacrifice your well-being in order to punish someone who misbehaved. And to get people to punish altruistically, they have to be fooled into it. Hence, evolution might have wired our minds to think that revenge will make us feel good. Another possibility might be that certain groups of societies, such as those in largely lawless Somalia or in areas of the Middle East where tribal rule holds more sway than the national government, are more prone to seek revenge because there's just no other way to obtain justice, says McKee. quote, "By and large, these types of impulses have arisen and still exist where there's no recourse to law," he says. That can apply to cultures without a functional legal system, he says, or in groups that operate outside the law, like gangs and the mafia. Quote, "They have to rely on their own retaliatory methods," he says. Some of these cultures might not even experience the negative emotional backlash Carl Smith found in his study. In her experience, Gelfin says, cultures that place a high value on revenge offer more social support to avengers. But by looking into what motivates revenge and by increasing our knowledge about how revenge makes us feel, it might be possible to combine the best aspect of justice and revenge. For example, McKee studies ways that institutional punishment can merge with victims' wishes to participate in that punishment. Victim impact statements, where victims are allowed to describe their ordeal and offer input on an offender's sentencing, have become common in U.S., Australian, and Finnish courts. That can partially satisfy a victim's vengeful feelings while also putting the responsibility for punishment on the state, protecting the victim from the rumination trap, Carl Smith describes. Quote, "Them victims sort of get the best of both worlds," McKee says. So I thought that was pretty interesting, especially in regards to the Kanika Jenkins case, obviously. And I just wanted to kind of touch on this. You know, I put the video out yesterday showing all the people that have been affected by the case or had any kind of connection to the case and all the people they had lost. And I just kind of wanted to elaborate on that. I work really, really hard at not judging people, and that's a constant struggle that I have, and I really have came a long way with that. I don't know what storm God has asked somebody to walk through, so it's not my place to judge them. You know, I don't know who gives you the authority to think you can judge someone. Is Jesus hiring? I'm saying, like, it took somebody that I really, really love to make me realize that all feelings aren't fact. And I used to really write off my emotions and my feelings, but all feelings are not fact. And even though I didn't want to hear it at the time, it took me a while to really understand what that person was trying to say to me. And I really consciously worked on it. Judging really defines who you are. It doesn't define them or affect them in any way. You know, we don't know what they're going through. You don't know the options that a person had to go through or the options that person had to choose from when they made the choice that they made. And while I do believe in an eye for an eye and reaping what you sow and what comes around goes around, you know, I believe in what you give is what you get, cause and effect. You get served what you deserve. I believe in all that. You know, you're facing the consequences of your choices. You know, I do believe that. But when you look at this case, you may think you understand the story. We may think we know what happened, or we have an opinion as to what happened. And I get tickled because I see these comments and these lives like, this happened. Someone is definitively saying that this happened to Kanika or that happened to Kanika. You do not have the proof. I don't care what you say. You do not have the proof of what happened. If we did have the proof, this case would be open and shut, period. And this is exactly what juries play on. the attorneys, they play on the jury's emotions. And if they can get a jury to become emotionally invested in a case, man, they got it made. So while I do have an opinion on what happened in this case, and my opinion is based off of what I see and what I've learned and what I've researched and all of that, I don't have a definitive for that. It's my feelings. And like I said, all feelings are not fact. All feelings are not fact. Now, you can show me footage and all that, and I can go right along with it. But it doesn't mean it's true. And I just wanted people to understand that. So, specifically, when I mentioned the people that had lost their life, you know, that had any kind of tie to this case, you know, like just for example, Lil Ty. I have never once heard his name mentioned as being a culprit in anything. And I've been on the case since jump. He was 16 years old when this party happened. He's just a baby. 15, 16 years old. And I've never heard his name brought up as being someone that did something to her. You know, he has a family. And while I am aware that Kanika also had a family and a life to live and all of that, we don't know. We truly don't know who is guilty of what. And until we do, then we can't come up with this, you know, what goes around comes around. You get served what you deserve. The evil you do remains with you. We don't get to say that. Number one, it's not our place. For real, it's not our place to do that. I want to get justice for Kanika. I want someone to pay for this crime that committed the crime. I don't want to sit here and point the finger at 40 people all because they're guilty of showing up at a party or a, quote, kickback that really probably wasn't even a kickback. You know what I mean? Not everybody in that party did something. So you can't really point the finger at everyone in the party just because they were guilty of going to this party. Now, if you truly believe that, if you truly believe that this 30-plus party group all had something to do with this, you don't think somebody in that group would have been done talked by now? Come on, man. Come on. Let's think logically. While I do believe that Monifa and Shamaya and Bri all knew what was going on, I can't prove that without a shadow of a doubt. Because if I could, everyone else could as well, and there would be a criminal case going on. So while I do believe that they had something to do with it, you know, Bri's dad didn't have anything to do with her going to the party. You know what I'm saying? Her auntie, Monifa's auntie, didn't have anything to do with her going to the party. So should my aunt have to pay karma for me going to a party where something happened? Hell, she didn't even know I was at the party. You know what I'm saying? So you got to really watch how you view this. Because you're saying one thing and you might be meaning something else. While I can't say that I have necessarily sympathy for them, I have empathy. I don't know them. You know, I don't know their families. But I can imagine Lil Ty's mother being completely distraught about losing her son. Because I have a son. I have sons. So I can relate on that level. But until we get some kind of proof, which is what we're lacking, which is what we're all looking for, you can't say what you're saying about karma, because we don't know. We don't know what somebody's karma is, because we don't know what their role was in this whole thing. They could be completely innocent. Do I think Lenny Posayas had something to do with it? Absolutely. Absolutely. But that's my opinion. And I don't push my opinion down people's throats. You probably won't be able to find where I've made an opinion about what I think happened in this case, because I purposely don't do that. Because based off of things that I see, my opinion may change daily. May change daily about what I think happened. I do think the hotel is guilty. I do think the Rosemont Police Department botched this entire investigation. Do I think they did it intentionally? Some days I do. Do I think they're just dumbasses? Some days I do. So, just kind of think about what you say before you say it. Because who are you to point the finger at someone? Who are you to judge them? That's a real question you should ask yourself. All feelings are not fact. And it took me a long time to learn that. A long time. And it was a hard dose to swallow. Because I was a very emotional person. And would just, if I thought somebody had slighted me, man, I was ready to rip their head off. You got to look at it from another view. So I hope that, it's actually called growth. Is what it's called. And I've experienced a lot of growth in the last year. I hope that someone took something away from this. You can't just remain the same throughout your life. I don't give a damn how old you are. You can't. You've got to grow in some kind of way. You've got to want to grow. You've got to. You can't just remain the same old grumpy ass person. I always look for something to better myself. Be it through reading or researching or watching something. Because you can never, never be too old to learn. And knowledge is power. It truly is. So anyways, I just wanted to bring that up. So that maybe it might make a few just kind of think about what they say. And be mindful of what you say. So I want justice just like everyone else. I just wanted to make sure everybody knew that. So, I hope you guys have a great day. I'm working on something and may have it out by the end of the day. So, have a great day, guys. Thanks for watching. Thanks for giving me your time.